Welcome to George Mason University. Welcome to the Science and Technology Campus of George Mason University for this very, very exciting afternoon. For those of you that I have not had the privilege to meet, my name is Fernando Miralles Villam, and yes, there will be a spelling test after, as part of the assignment after this talk. But it is my honor to serve as Dean of the College of Science at George Mason. And I'll be also your host for the afternoon. This is part of a series of events that we have named the Mason Science Series. And it just so happens that to be the first one that we do here at the Prince William County, what we call Manassas, what we call SciTech, right, or SciTech campus. And we usually do these in Fairfax, but you know, given this attendance, I think we're going to start doing more of these here because this is wonderful. The purpose of this, the Mason Science Series, is really to showcase the cutting edge research that our faculty do and the very exciting things that many of our scientists are doing, and today is going to be no exception to that. We bring our expert faculty to share their work with the community. We'll have, the main part of the event is about a discussion that may last maybe 40, 45 minutes, but certainly we encourage you to stay with follow-up discussion, and there'll be, the refreshments now, there'll continue to be refreshments after the event so we can continue the discussion. Before I introduce our guest today, just a little bit of housekeeping. I want to give a shout out to our colleagues at GMU TV who are recording the event. The event will be available in the Mason website, and these guys do a fantastic job in putting the videos together, and it's a great, great production. One thing that is special about this campus is that this is the site where Mason is locating our forensic science program. We have a mix of people now in Fairfax and here, but we plan to really establish the program here. This is the perfect location for today's talk. It's forensic science at George Mason University, the intersection of science and justice. Let me tell you a little bit about our forensic science program. It was founded in 2008. It is a national leader in forensic anthropology and forensic science. Let me give you some stats on the program. We have over 650 graduates. We currently have around 430 undergraduates and 75 graduate students currently enrolled in the program. We offer a Bachelor of Science, Master of Science degrees in forensic sciences. And we also have, as you can probably guess, we have lots of students from other majors that are interested in, and they minor in forensic science or they take classes. And it's a very versatile program that reaches, you know, far beyond the program itself and the College of Science. It reaches, you know, the entire university. It is definitely one of our more popular programs, and it's growing steadily. And it's really, thanks to the exciting and innovative curriculum, the faculty that we have, they're doing so very interesting things. The Crime Scene House Laboratory, which opened in 2017, so there is a real facility that students can do their work in. We opened a 5-acre science and research training lab that's only one of eight nationally, and it's the only one in the East Coast that is capable of performing outdoor research. I'm going to get this right. Outdoor research in forensic science using human donors. Yes, what's so-called a body farm. And I was talking to a few of you outside, and the question that I got the most is, what is a body farm? We'll get to answer that question in today's conversation. I want to introduce my distinguished colleague and guest, Professor Dr. Mary Ellen O'Toole. And she's going to be joining me here in a minute, but let me tell you a little bit about her specifically. It's fascinating, fascinating background. She's the director of a forensic science program. She joined Mason in 2015 and has been the director since. Before that, she spent her entire career studying the criminal mind. She spent 28 years with the FBI and is considered one of the most senior profiles for the Bureau. Just to do some name dropping, right? Not that I like to brag, but Dr. O'Toole has helped capture some of the world's most infamous people and has helped solve some of the biggest crimes of our generation, including, but not limited to, Ted Kaczynski, the Unabomber, right? Gary Ridgway, the Green River Killer. The Red Lake School Shooting, the Zodiac Serial Murder Case, the Polyclass Child Abduction, and the bombing during the 2002 Olympics in Salt Lake City, Utah. She also worked on the Elizabeth Smart and Natalie Holloway disappearances, the Columbine shooting, and many other high-profile cases during her career. Her law enforcement career spans over 32 years, beginning in the San Francisco District Attorney's Office, where she was a criminal investigator. For those of you who like a good media reference, Dr. O'Toole spent most of her 28 year at the Bureau in the organization's prestigious Behavioral Analysis Unit, BAU, the very unit that inspired the hit crime series, Criminal Minds. Hold your applause, because I'm not done. During her time in the unit, Dr. O'Toole developed expertise in criminal investigative analysis and offender behavior. She has helped law enforcement and prosecutors with a wide range of violent and criminal behavior. She is recognized at the FBI as the FBI's leading expert in psychopathy. And her work in this area put her at the forefront of mental health and law enforcement efforts to apply this to both violent and white-collar offender cases. Dr. O'Toole is also a trained FBI hostage negotiator. She served as an adjunct faculty member at the FBI's prestigious Leadership Development Institute, LDI, and lectured at the Smithsonian Institution about everything from Sherlock Holmes to personal safety. Actually, when we were outside, she was giving one of my colleagues some advice on why she should not keep her doors unlocked at Fairfax, right? And I'm not going to tell who that is because she knows who she is. Dr. O'Toole is a fellow of the American Academy of Forensic Sciences. Welcome, Mary Ellen. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. And we're going to get comfortable in the podium and we'll start our show. How about that? Is that a good plan?
Excellent.
Excellent. You know, while we get seated and get started, I'm going to go a little bit off script, but I couldn't resist. And Mary Ellen has heard this story many times. You know, I grew up in, you know, I was born in the 60s, so I grew up in the 70s and 80s watching cop shows. So anything from Kojak to Starsky and Hutch, and I'm going to start, you know, but I do see some people nodding, so you know who you are. You watch those shows with me, right? And that has evolved, you know, all the CSIs, all the, you know, the cold case. And so to me, when I joined Mason 4 years ago as dean, and, you know, I learned I have a forensic science program in my portfolio. That was so cool, right? So, I've learned quite a great deal working with our faculty. So I'm not just your host. I'm here, and my face is going to tell my awe, because I feel this awe with our colleagues. I also want to mention that we're going to be talking with Mary Ellen today, but the forensic science program is a whole group of people, a whole group of researchers. We have a few of our faculty are sitting here in the front row today. I'll just give a quick shout out to some of our faculty, Emily Rancourt, say hi. Yeah, there you go. Chris Durek. Brian Eckenrode. There he is. Dr. Anyi Dim. And Edward. Edward joined us recently, so. So Mary Ellen, I've given my version of the forensic science program, which is, you know, it's gonna pale in comparison to you describing it. Can you tell us a little bit about the program and, you know, and then we'll delve into what attracted you to come to Mason and join us.
Sure. Well, welcome everyone. It's an honor for me to be here in front of such a prestigious group. Our forensic science program is based in application with real science. So what that means is that the program is steeped in the sciences, chemistry, biology, physics, mathematics, but the way we use the science is to apply it to real-world problems, specifically criminal behavior. And that application becomes extremely important because when you go out to a crime scene, you're going to use that mathematics, you're going to use your forensic biology, your forensic chemistry to collect the evidence, to analyze the evidence, to testify in court, and hopefully help the prosecutor, the judge, and the trier of fact to resolve the case by identifying the person that's responsible. So that's a little different than just a theoretically based program, and I think that's the reason that we really loved having all of these initiatives that our students love even more than we do. They love the idea of a body farm. Their parents' eyes kind of roll over in their head when we first started to talk about a body farm, but they love the idea of being out there and studying what happens to people when they are decomposing, because that helps to solve crimes. That helps to solve cases. They love going into our crime scene house, the crime scene house which is staged by our special projects manager, Chris Durack, to make it look like real crime scenes have occurred in the different rooms of each house. In fact, you do that a little bit too well. It's scaring me a little bit here. But they actually apply their knowledge to demonstrate to Professor Rancor how you do go into a house and collect evidence in a way that preserves it, in a way that protects it, so that it can go to the laboratory where Dr. Eckenrode worked for 23 years as an analytical chemist and run the right tests so you have strong scientific results, again, that you can bring into court. So I think our program has the theory, but it has the application. And it sounds like a fun program because it is, but our students are learning really hard how to apply their knowledge in real life situations.
It's wonderful, wonderful. See, I told you she was gonna do a much better characterization of the program, so. So I introduced you, you started off as a criminal investigator, became a profiler. So how do you land at Mason? What attracted you to come here? Tell us if Mason has changed a little bit what you do and how you approach things.
It's a great question. I'll do my very best. After I retired from the FBI, after 28 years as an FBI agent, I thought I would go and run my own consulting business, but I hated my boss. And I decided I couldn't work for her anymore. So the job opened up here at Mason, and one of Professor Rancor's students, who was a graduate of the program, and she was working with me at the time, suggested that I apply for it. And I thought, I'm never going to get that job. Why do I really want to waste my time applying for it? And they convinced me to do it against what I thought at the time was my better judgment. No one wants to get that call that says, sorry, thanks for applying, but you're not getting it. And lo and behold, I got the job. And I think one of the reasons that I did, quite honestly, is because as a profiler, contrary to Criminal Minds, how many people here watch Criminal Minds? Oh my gosh. You better lock your door while you're doing it, too. It's nothing like what we do for the FBI. It's nothing like that. But in a perfect world, when we do profile a case, we've got all the behavioral information that we need to understand, for example, how a homicide occurred. But we also have all of the forensic reports. We don't go to active crime scenes. They do on Criminal Minds, but we don't do that. Professor Rancor would do that, but we don't. What we do is wait for all the reports to come in, and then we look at what does the DNA evidence say? What does the blood spatter tell us? What about the forensic chemistry? So by the time I get everything, I've got the behavioral reports, I've got the interviews, I've got all the forensic reports, and I blend them all together. So it's my responsibility to have a certain amount of information in all those areas so I can pull that puzzle piece together. And I think it was that experience that really enabled me to convince them that I was the right person for the job.
Yes,
I hope so.
And right you've been, no question about that. We're really happy that you've joined us. So let me dig a little bit into what is it like to interview serial killers and other high-profile offenders, and you know what are these people like, and what can we learn from how they are?
Sometimes I tell my students that, as much of an animal lover as I am, that I would rather, as opposed to getting a puppy at Christmas time, I would rather talk to a serial killer. Right? And I'll tell you why. Look to your right, look to your left right now. Just look at the people around you. Can you tell if anybody around you or next to you has just committed a violent crime by looking at them? You cannot. You absolutely cannot. And yet that's what's portrayed. What's that? Yeah. But you can't tell by physically looking at someone that they're violent or dangerous. And that's the one thing that I realized when talking to these serial offenders, is that they look as normal as you and me. And they come across one of the traits that they have that's consistent with someone that has a psychopathic personality. The old term was sociopath. They are very extroverted. They love to talk, and they're extremely charming. When I interviewed Gary Leon Ridgway, who's the Green River Killer, the most prolific serial killer in U.S. history, he pled guilty to 51 murders in one county in the state of Washington. We don't even know how many people he murdered in Portland and Spokane and Tacoma and other places. To sit across the table from him was the most interesting thing in the world. And myself as an introvert, you don't have to do a lot with these people. They do all the talking. And you know what they like to talk about? They like to talk about themselves. And with Gary, he wanted to convince me that he was the best serial killer in the United States, in the world. Who talks like that? Who says crazy stuff like that? But I just sat and I listened for 6 months and listen to what he had to say. So talking to these individuals, you get into how they think they got that way, what they did to the victims, how they eluded law enforcement, and all the time you're thinking, I'm going to need that for the next case. I'm going to need that for the next crime scene. And one of the things we learned with Gary Leon Ridgway is how he was disposing of his bodies and how he was accessing victims. One of the things we couldn't figure out was how he was getting these women to get into the car with him. These were very street savvy women. And they would go up to the car, and Gary said he would show them his driver's license, and then he would say, oh, they would ask him, are you that serial killer? And he'd say, no. Because look, I have my little boy's toys in the car. I couldn't be that serial killer. And I got to thinking as I was talking to him, and I took a risk, and I said, but Gary, what would happen if you had your little boy in the car and he's sleeping in the back seat? He was 3 years old at the time, but he was verbal 3 years old. I said, what would happen if your little boy woke up while you're murdering one of the women in the front seat? And very casually, he looked at me and he said, I'd have killed him. So understanding the profound callousness of these individuals is enormous. And how does that help? Because when people go in to do interviews, you cannot give them empathy, you cannot give them kindness, you cannot give them traits they don't have. So understanding that and learning as much as I could was really helpful in training other law enforcement people to be good interviewers, because these people are very different. These people are, and they're not fixable when they get to that point. There is no cure for someone who's a psychopathic serial sexual killer. So knowing that I could learn so much from them was just enormously rewarding.
Wow. I don't know about you guys. I'm stunned here. So, in your experience, you know, how is the work of forensic science and members of the FBI Behavioral Analysis Unit, where you were for a long time, how is that different from what we, I mean, I was describing watching cop shows, watching cop movies, and we see in the film and in the media, what are the realities and what are the not, you know, the things that they don't get right?
Sure. Well, one of the biggest things that they get wrong on Criminal Minds is that the FBI does not have its own Learjet. We get our airplanes through drug raids that we take your property if we do a drug raid at your airport, so we get your airplanes that are left over. And we don't work as individual crime solvers. We're part of a team. So there's not one person that can sort of pound their chest and say, I've solved this case all by myself. And profiling is a tool. It's like the polygraph exam. It's like any other investigative tool. Together, we solve cases. It's not like you go in and you take over and you're the heroes. You go in quietly, you provide your expertise, other agents provide theirs, other law enforcement agencies provide theirs, and then collectively cases get solved. It's not a one-person show. And I think that the TV programs, we all love them, I do too, but they depict that there's always one lone hero, and that's simply not the case.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the program here at Mason and how it ties to this experience and specifically, let's talk a little bit about the body farm and the crime house lab, right? And how these facilities, what these facilities bring to the program, and also how can those facilities help solve real crimes?
Sure. So we'll start with the crime scene house. Mm-hmm. The crime scene house is a real house. Right now it's in Fairfax, Virginia. And we're able to set up each room as an individual crime scene, just like the students will encounter when they're hired by Prince William County or Arlington Police or go to work for the military. And we have cameras set up in one area of the house so that our professors, like Chris and like Professor Rancor, can watch students as they perform their work in each one of the rooms. Because one of the things that you have to do as a crime scene investigator is you have to take it very seriously. So you can't go into a crime scene with a bottle of water. You can't go in with a sandwich in your pocket. And you can't go in laughing. You have to take it very, very seriously. And they learn these things once they're inside the house, and they're expected to look for the evidence. And once they find the evidence, you have to know how to package it up correctly, so the evidence is not ruined. How many cases have we all heard about over the years where physical evidence was collected but not stored properly, and what happened to it? It was ruined, never to be recovered again. So they learn all of that inside the house, and they also learn this, which is really the meat and the potatoes of forensic science. That's not good enough to just collect the evidence. What you have to do then is go into court, which is a very stressful thing to do, go into court and you testify to what you did in that crime scene house. You testified how you found the evidence, you testified as to how you packaged it, and if you work in the lab as a forensic chemist or a forensic DNA analyst, you testified to your processing and what you did to analyze that material. So all of that is what our students learn. It's a very serious job, and when you think about the consequences, that is really so important, because you've got someone there sitting at the defense table, and their whole life is over if you don't do the right job, if you don't give the right information, if you don't provide the right kind of analysis. There's a major case going on right now in Colorado. I don't know if anyone has followed it. There's a forensic DNA analyst who had worked for 30 years as a forensic DNA person. And they found that they fabricated some of the results. Now they have to go back over 30 years to look to find out how many cases were tainted. That's not the bad part. The bad part is now in every new case that comes up where forensic DNA analysis will be used, they will go back to that case and say, are you one of those DNA analysts? So we really have very high standards that we have to uphold. And that is really just stated and overstated to our students to understand this is a very important job. You have a tremendous amount of responsibility. And if you don't want that responsibility, this isn't the job for you. Then you want me to tell you about the body farm?
Let's talk about the body farm, yes.
So.
And not me, they want to know.
So the body farm was not really my idea. This was the dream of Professor Rancor. When I first came here, I asked Professor Rancor and Professor Rule, if you had a perfect world, what would you like? And at that time, they were using classrooms as the crime scene house. That's ridiculous. But I said, what else? What would be the perfect thing? And Emily said, a body farm. And I was like, what? Tell me more about this. And so she started to explain about the importance and how this would take us to a new level when it came to our program out here. And it made all the sense in the world. And we started to think, how do we present it to the university? How do we tell you about it? How do we present it to the community so that they don't think, oh no, hell no, not in my backyard? And it became apparent that when we really would talk about what could be done on the farm and the research that could be done and the importance of the research and what it meant, the statistics are overwhelming when you realize how many missing persons there are in the United States, when you realize how many unidentified human remains there are in medical examiners' offices throughout the United States. We have to have a better process, better science to identify people once they're dead, if they died as a result of exposure or if they died as a result of homicide. Our science has to be better. And it became clear once we spoke about that and talked about what we're going to do with that, what we're going to bring our students into to be a part of to improve the science, then it became easy to sell the program. And then we had Dr. Eckenrode join us, who again is our analytical chemist. Dr. Andy Yim join us, who is our forensic anthropologist. We're looking at science intersecting with law enforcement, intersecting with criminal investigations. And one of the kind of exciting things that I really enjoy talking about and thinking about is we're going to actually train cadaver dogs. You've all heard of cadaver dogs, right? And you know, you've seen them on TV, you've seen how they work. Do you know, we don't know how the dog does it. We still don't know what it is that they are smelling. Can you imagine that? After all this time, we still don't know. So our first experiment on the body farm, thanks to Dr. Eckenrode and Dr. Yim, is we're going to explore the smell that these dogs are picking up when they can go right to where a body has been dumped on the ground or buried in a shallow grave, but we just don't know what it is that they're smelling. We have to understand the smell of human decomposition. And Professor Rancor is actually heading up a project on how we can use honeybees. How we can use honeybees to figure out where somebody has been buried or figure out where somebody has been disposed of. That's never been done before. This is cutting-edge research, but it's going to make a difference to law enforcement, to investigations, and you know what the bottom line is? It's going to make a difference when it comes to families whose loved ones have been on the receiving end of this kind of behavior. A family never gets closure, but they always want to know what's happened to their loved ones. So we have a real responsibility to make sure our science is the best it can be, and we want to make a difference. And I think with the expertise that we have here right in the front row, this science is going to make a difference.
That's wonderful. Wonderful. Now, you mentioned we have a crime scene house in Fairfax. And I know we're in discussions to build a crime scene house here. So can you tell us a little bit about is there going to be anything different from the new crime scene house that we would do here? How is that going to tie to the body farm? And how, you know, where is the, what's the big opportunity here?
The big opportunity here is that the house will be based on the needs of the program, but also based on the needs of our law enforcement partners. So, for example, our small, humble crime scene house in Fairfax is used by different police departments for training purposes. But once you use a house over and over again in training, you know where that wall is. You know where that floorboard is. You know where all the light sockets are. So what we want to do is to create a house where we have movable walls. We want to create a house where we can wash down. Can you tell I'm from the Midwest? Washed. I can't get rid of that. We want to wash down the walls. We want to be able to set up different scenarios in rooms that maybe we've used last week, but we can modify them so the student is not anticipating what that new room will look like. So it's going to be modernized. It's going to give us the ability to clean the rooms on a regular basis. It also is going to do something that I really want to do. And this has been my passion since coming here. Because we know that more and more young people are coming into forensic science and they learn about it in K through 12. We want to have a room in the crime scene house that will serve as a museum for young people to come in and hear about law enforcement and see what it means. And we'll have different instructors come in, their teachers will come in, and they will teach classes. And the other thing that I really want to do is, we are so blessed to have the initiatives that we do here at Mason. The crime scene house, the DNA lab, the Faro lab, the body farm. There are some universities that have brilliant students, right? But they're thousands of miles away. And I've had experience working with HBCUs and tribal colleges and universities. I want to bring those universities and colleges in through virtual reality and be able to have Professor Rancor or Chris standing at the body farm or in a crime scene house, and through virtual reality, we're bringing in students from that HBCU or that tribal university. So they have that kind of experience that our students here at Mason are fortunate enough to have. And for me, that's going to be the dream come true if we can make that work. And I think we can.
All right. All right. So I did not write this question, of course, but I need to ask it. So how can people donate financially and their bodies to the farm, the body farm and the crime house?
So two separate questions there.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So we'll start with right now with the body farm. We are waiting for our first donor. Our donors are coming through the Virginia Anatomical Board, which is located in Richmond. And that they are the arm of the medical examiner's office that will supply donors, human donors, to medical schools. So our requirements for being placed on the farm are not nearly as stringent as if you were to donate your body to science and you go to a university, to a medical school. So the reason we're going through the Virginia Anatomical Board is because they have lots of experience in screening bodies, and we want the bodies to be screened for contagious diseases. That's important because we're going to have students and faculty out there. And believe it or not, we've had many people contact us who want to donate their bodies.
There you go. There you go. Yes.
We wish you a long and happy life.
Yes.
But we are collecting donor information, and then we send it down to the Virginia Anatomical Board. But any day now, Professor Rancor's phone can ring. We could get notice that Richmond has a human donor, and we have our response team ready to go. Everybody you see lined up here will be a part of the response team. We will meet the hearse right over here by where your cars are parked. They won't be then. And then we will transport the human donor into the body farm. We already know the experiment. Dr. Yim and Dr. Eckenrode had already set up the experiment. We've already have the whole dug in the body farm. So we are ready to go. We just have to wait for that phone call to come in. So people are so generous. To think about donating your body to science is such a gift. And we absolutely appreciate that gift more than you can ever imagine. Now the crime scene house. We can't move our crime scene house from Fairfax to here. So we are now looking at trying to kind of financially set ourselves up that we can build a new crime scene house out here. That is the biggest part of our program, our students who want to be CSI investigators. That's probably well over 50%. So our crime scene house is actually pivotal to our entire program. So right now we're waiting and we're in limbo just to make sure we have enough money to build a house out here. The house, if we have enough money, will be up on the hill. When you walk out, if you look over to your left, you'll see what's called the edge, which is a workout area. Believe that our house will go up there, which will be in close proximity to the body farm. So our students will be able to walk from the house to the body farm and then to our new building, which you drove past when you came here, the new LSEB building, which is right over here. So it will be incredible that it will be so self-contained, and we can have all of our students out here with great labs, with great opportunities, with great resources. So that's our goal once we make this final move, which will be actually in January of next year. But hopefully we'll have a crime scene house by then.
Yep, and we're working towards that. And you know, donations, contributions are always welcome for this great cause. And having the crime scene house and the body farm here is definitely going to be a game changer in this, right? So we talked a little bit about the program and the faculty and the infrastructure. So looking forward, let's say we have an ideal world over the next 10 years. Where will the forensic science program at Mason be at that time? What should we be looking to do? What should be our investments in people and facilities? What do you think? Let's say we do the crime scene house, right, and do the body farm, and you have great faculty. What's next?
So what's next over the next 10 years would be to grow our faculty. We are a small faculty. We do a lot with a little. We have 10 full-time faculty members. So growing our program will allow us to keep up with our students because we have over 500 students. So if we have more faculty, we'll be able to offer more courses, and with more courses, we'll be able to go into maybe different directions in terms of what we can offer the students. So that would be the one thing we want to do. At some point, we would like to have almost a global center out here. So we're in the DMV. What better place can we be than here in Northern Virginia to offer this collaborative initiative to our partners, both at federal and on the state level, to have a much bigger center where we could do training, collaborative training, where we could do collaborative research, where we could do even an additional crime scene area to offer to people from smaller departments throughout Virginia, throughout Maryland, West Virginia, that don't have the opportunity to train in a global center. So not unlike the Potomac Science Building. So that would certainly be on our list. When it comes to things that are related to the body farm, we want to do more bone research. We want to expand on our DNA. One of our professors, we have three wonderful DNA forensic professors, and one of them is also retired from the FBI, and some of his research is absolutely amazing. And he is extracting from bones, DNA from bones. Do you know how important that is? Because the number of bones that are found everywhere in the United States go unidentified, sometimes forever. But if we can learn how to extract DNA from bones that is not degraded, we would be able to do what they did in the case out in California, where they identified the serial murder after 30 years, down to the point where you could tell the color of somebody's eyes. So in order to do that, we have to expand on these programs, and with expansion comes the need for more laboratories, more instrumentation, but the end result is wonderful.
Yes, no, I completely agree. I don't want to ask you any more questions because I want to have a time with the audience and have them perhaps throw in a question for you. Let's start with there, and can just before you ask your question, we'll get you a mic. Just tell us your name and your affiliation, or you know where you come from. Tell us something about yourself. Why are you interested in this topic?
Hi. Is it on? Yeah. I'm John Durham. I'm a faculty spouse. And a couple of years ago, I read a book called The Psychopath Test. And it talked about several things, but one thing it talked about was this, a test that was developed and administered to convicts as they were approaching parole. And the other thing they talked about was the difficulty in dealing with psychopaths who come up for parole, because they don't know whether they're really expressing remorse or whether they are merely saying what the parole board would like them to hear. And I was just wondering, A, about the test, and B, about any of your experience with this conundrum of psychopaths.
I absolutely love that question. You're a plant, aren't you? So it's very true that when individuals, just a little background on psychopathy, about Dr. Robert Hare is considered the world's expert in psychopathy and has studied it for over 50 years, and he developed the test for psychopathy, which is not the test that you had mentioned. The test that Dr. Hare developed is called the Psychopathy Checklist Revised, or the acronym is PCLR. It's a test where the perfect score is 40. So if I were to give you the test, you don't want to be a 40. Psychopaths test 20 and higher. White-collar psychopaths are in the mid-20s, and then I only met one offender. He's the worst person I've ever met in my life. He scored a perfect 40. Most offenders are never given that test. Most offenders, even when they come up for parole, are never given that test. And the reason is, they're not required to do it in a prison facility. Now, the research does support the fact that when people that manifest traits of psychopathy, I have to say it that way unless I've tested them, that they manifest traits of psychopathy, when they come before the parole board, just like when I interview them in a different setting, they are so full of remorse. I would never do it again. I felt so bad after I murdered 49 people. But they are so believable, and they can mimic emotion so well that they are oftentimes given release when non-psychopaths who are not as sophisticated and don't know how to come across well are denied release. So it's a very challenging situation to be in when you realize that people that can feign emotions, that don't feel them at all, can convince a parole board, heck, they convince you and me that they've changed. So that's you're on the money when you said that.
Great. Yes, Mark.
Hi. I guess it's worked. My name's Mark Monson. I am currently the president of the College of Science alumni chapter. And as a graduate of George Mason, I finished in 73. There were only 1,500 students, by the way, at George Mason when I graduated. So the whole concept of the forensic science program is just tremendously exciting from an old alumni standpoint. But my question is, and you've talked a lot about how science informs the work that you're doing. And you've talked a lot about interviewing various psychopaths but there has been a tremendous amount of work done in psychology and in neuroscience at looking at the structure of brains of the various psychopathies. So my question is, how does that side of science inform the work that you do dealing with the behavior? Because all you can see is the behavior. So how are you that part of science informing the work that's being done in dealing with the behavior and learning from the behavior side? Does that make sense?
Total sense. The original research that was done on psychopathy was primarily done by Dr. Robert Hare up in Canada. And what they did was scans of the brain to see what the differences were between those that scored very high on this PCLR and those that didn't. And that research is what enabled them to say, in that area of the brain where the emotions are, the empathy, kindness, remarkably dull in that area of the brain when it came to psychopaths. Whereas with non-psychopaths, all of us in here, when you start doing testing where it elicits some kind of an emotional response, that part of our brain really lights up. So that's the basis, actually, for the test, the PCLR. The problem is they also learned that because of the research, it does look like psychopathy has a very heavy genetic dose to it, which is concerning. But I think 50 years from now, we're going to find out many psychological issues, just like many medical issues, have a very heavy dose of genetics to them. Now, I was just on a conference call today. Something interesting to blend neuroscience into the behavioral science is that we also know that with young people, and I'm talking people that are still in their teens and early 20s, do you want to know the good news or the bad news about your personalities?
Both.
I'll give you the good news. The good news is by the time when you're born, up until the time you're in your mid to late 20s, your personality is forming and changing. That makes sense, right? Guess what happens when you get to your late 20s, early 30s? Boom. Your personality is hardwired. And how many of us have heard people say over the years, that is not the person I married? Yeah, kind of is. But the whole issue with understanding neuroscience is that the part of your brain that is still forming up until the time you get to be in your early 30s means that young offenders, if there is an opportunity for rehabilitation, it is before they reach the point where their brains become really hardwired. That's what really the critical message is. And now some of the neuroscience is also telling us something that is terrifying to me. It's suggesting that our brains are human brains based on going back to the ages of dinosaurs and cavemen. We've developed this us against them mentality where it only takes a matter of seconds before I look at you and I say, we're different or we're not different. And that us against them mentality, if not held in check or if not noted, can go on to produce thinking processes that pit you against people who are not like you, for whatever that reason is. So that becomes really important. And then finally, I would just say this. Before the behavior starts, violence starts in the brain. One of the most terrifying videotapes that I ever saw were the tapes of the Columbine High School shooters. And I had to review them for court to offer an opinion as to whether or not they should ever be released to the media. That planning started at least 1 year before. physical planning, the thinking in the brain went well beyond that period of time. Violence starts in the brain, and then we see the behavior. It may be behavior that comes about 10 minutes after I start thinking about it, or 10 years ago. So we've got to blend neuroscience, we've got to blend the science together with the behavior, because they all contribute to the end result. When Professor Rancor and Chris Durek, my faculty, are working on a homicide, it didn't just happen 2 seconds ago. It goes back. And we've got to be able to blend all that together.
Great.
Hi. Is it on? Okay, there it is. Hi. I'm Matthew Forker. I'm from Fire Safety here with the university. The question I'm kind of thinking of for, I don't know, whoever wants to answer it, but you guys are talking about like emerging technologies and emerging processes and sciences that in the field of forensic science, it can help contribute to justice and finding justice for victims, but also for, I guess, punishments of perpetrators. But along with those emerging technologies, what kind of ethical considerations come up? And I guess what considerations go into weighing the risks versus the rewards of using those new technologies?
Can you be specific about the technologies?
I guess maybe just as one example, as something like DNA evidence. I guess one example off the top of my head, something like a breathalyzer. That hasn't always been around, but the usage of it, you know, it calls into question like, well, what are the guidelines and boundaries for police officers to have consent to use a breathalyzer? Mm-hmm. What if a suspect, someone who's suspected of drinking and driving, refuses to use a breathalyzer? You know, where does the benefit of the technology end and the introduction of whether it's rightful to use it against or for the public, start coming into question? I hope that makes sense the way I phrased it.
No, it's a great question. And it's always a very fine balancing act when you have a technology, but you always have to be very aware of what the parameters are and what that person's rights are to use that kind of technology. And I know in the area of DNA, like for example, and if I start to go off, one of my faculty are going to tell me this, but right now we've all heard of the Golden State Killer, right? The one man in California who was a police officer and he murdered up and down the coast and then went dormant for 30 years and then he was arrested, not too really all that long ago. And forensic genealogy was really what identified him. They were able to get a sample and they went back in time and they went back as far as his great-great-grandmother and they were able to identify him. But here's the issue with genetic genealogy. There was a point at which if you contributed your DNA to Ancestry, there was a point at which that automatically went into law enforcement. And now, no can do. Now you have to agree for your DNA to go into a database that will be used by law enforcement. Now, and it's voluntary. Now, do we hope more people will agree to do that? We absolutely do, because in talking to our DNA people, they've said that the databases right now that we're using are pretty small. And I think we could solve a lot more cases, but if you don't want your DNA used by law enforcement, we have to respect that. But it has evolved over time. Does that make sense? And I think that's what's happened in a number of different technologies, that mistakes have been made, and we've had to, course correction, and then go back and change things. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, we had a question back there and then front here. Mm-hmm.
Hi, is this working? Yeah. I'm Don Benyevich. I'm a retired public policy analyst, and I'm not sure how to ask this. You're a profiler, and that's great, and yet we have this thing about profiling, and it raises up a police did profiling, and that's terrible, but it's not. How can we use the knowledge that's being developed to help prevent crime without the ethical issues that have been mentioned? I know that we're using statistics now to try to find areas where crime's more likely and move our resources there, but there must be more we can do. in that regard.
Are you talking specifically about profiling?
Yes, the knowledge that's coming out of this field can contribute to things that help prevent crime as well as solve crime.
Great question. Where we are with violence prediction is this. We can prevent violence, but it's very difficult to predict violence, if that makes sense. Now, the FBI did away with the word profiler years and years ago, but it's one of those words that just sticks around and we can't get rid of it. We're actually called criminal investigative analysts because we analyze crime scenes to be able to solve them. So the way I would use it in serial murder cases is, again, I would look at all the behavioral and the forensic evidence, and I would come up with an idea of what the person's personality was, how they committed the crime, maybe a little bit about their background. And then I would always be asked, will they do this again? And again, prediction and prevention are two separate things. If it's a serial offender, it's a little easier to say that, but some serial killers just stop cold turkey. They do. But we always were trained to be very careful about saying 100% certain this person is going to act out again, because human behavior is not that rigid that you can predict it. There are reasons people might stop, so you have to be very careful and know the limitations of the science. But I can tell you this, over the last 25, 30 years, we've come a lot further in understanding crime scene behavior and being able to take a look at certain things. For example, one thing we did get blindsided on, before Columbine happened, I did the FBI's research on mass shootings. We struggled to find 18 mass shootings, and then boom, Columbine hit. We had never seen a case like the Columbine High School shooting, unless you went back to 1966, August 1, down in Austin, the Texas Tower shooting. We did not see that coming. We did not really have the internet then. Little House on the Prairie was the popular TV show. What the hell happened that caused Columbine? So now we are going forward, and now the new research is looking at where are the mass shootings going to be in 5 years from now? What are the trends going to be in mass shooting? And they're looking at all the cultural and societal factors that could come into play in order to predict where we will be with mass shootings 10 years from now. Will we be 100% accurate? I don't think so, but we'll be better.
I had a question in front here. Yeah, there we go.
Thanks.
Hi, thank you. I'm Pamela Epler, and I am Mason alumni, but I'm also a PhD candidate in education and policy. And I've also been an adjunct here, professor here at Mason as well. I really am very impressed with this program and all of your knowledge, and I thank you so much for sharing it all. It's a real eye-opener. I have also been very impressed with the questions that have come forth from the audience. Mine is a very simple question, is with a body farm. I'm very unfamiliar with that. So when you say a body farm, what protections are you giving to that body farm? I'm assuming it's outdoors, and if it is, how do we protect it against violence coming in, you know, to destroy anything that might be there, or even wild animals that might have sense of smell that might come to that area?
That is a great question. And Emily, you, Andy, and Brian may want to weigh in on this. We are protecting it from a security point of view because we don't want kids to get in there. So it is protected by a double fence. It's 5 acres. A fence goes around all 5 acres, and then the inner 1 acre is where the human donors will be, and that has its own lock and key. So it is protected. We have the police department out here that provides the security for it. Now, here's the thing that is a little startling. If someone is, if their bodies are disposed after a murder, let's say, we have got to understand what the animal predators do to a human body. And so right now we do have pigs that are buried on the farm, one buried, one placed on top of the ground. And within days, the animal predators came in and they attacked the pigs. But that is the real world. That is what happens in the ecosystem. And it's important to know what those, and it will happen to our human donor. Now, we will put cages over the donors that are laying on top of the ground, but it is important to know what the patterns are when a human is attacked by a raccoon or a fox or whatever the predators are in this part of the country. I remember sitting around a consultation table at Quantico, Virginia, at the FBI Academy, and we were talking about a series of bodies that were left outside, and the offenders still had not been identified, and there were these incredible bruising marks on the victim. And people were talking about what kind of an offender would inflict post-mortem injuries like that, which is a totally different kind of offender than someone that does it peri-mortem or anti-mortem. And had some great research that came in from the body farm in Texas, and they found that they have incredibly large birds down there that come in and they just land on the donor. And guess what they were doing? Inflicting incredible bruising marks, bruising patterns to the victim that previously had been credited to a human donor. So it really is important that we don't cut the grass, we don't keep out the predators, that's part of the ecosystem, and we have to know how all of those factors blend together and what happens to the human donor when that ecosystem is allowed to just do what it does naturally. It's a great question. You're welcome.
Yes, there's a question in the back.
Hi, yes, I'm Jennifer DeSanto. I'm the executive director of the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute at George Mason University, and you've taught for us before, and we really, my colleagues are here with me, we've been really enthralled by this entire talk, so thank you so much. My question is about the psychopath personality, and you've talked about how it's hard to tell whether they're gonna, you know, commit a crime again after they've already been an offender. I have basically two questions. One is there any hope for psychopaths in the sense that maybe they won't act at all? And is there a way to self-identify and come forward if there's knowledge out there about particular traits and people can say, oh my gosh, you know, I mean, unless they have no capacity due to their condition to be able to self-reflect. And then the other question is about, really it was gonna be about this body farm, but you've covered that so much, so I'll just let that one be. Thank you.
Sure, so the question is really about psychopaths and can they sort of change their colors if they choose to. Psychopathy is a personality disorder, so it's not a mental illness. And it's hardwired by the same period of time, late 20s. It also, again, has that genetic dose to it. When you interact with psychopaths, they don't feel that there is anything wrong with them, so no need to change. I had one serial killer, and he was very quiet when we were talking. Most of them are very charismatic and very talkative. And I started to get frustrated, and finally I said, so Tommy, do you know what a psychopath is? And Tommy just got to a fifth grade education, and he had some serious kind of medical issues. And he said, yeah, I know. And I'm thinking, what, you know? And I said, well, how do you know? He said, I looked it up in the dictionary. And I said, so what is it? And he said, so I looked it up, and a psychopath is somebody without a conscience. And he said, Mary Ellen, that's a real good thing. It's a real good thing. So there are different programs that are involved with treating younger individuals that manifest traits of psychopathy based on the assumption that there's room for change as they get older. The success varies, though, just in terms of whether or not they can change these personality traits. Again, if it's a personality trait, really hard to change once it's once it is hardwired in the person. And once they get to be older, you're not going to change it. Dr. Hare estimates that about 1% of the population has psychopathic traits. We know what the traits are. I can list every one of the 20 traits of psychopathy. About 1% of the population, But the majority of individuals with these 20 traits are not violent until they are. Until they are. I had a number of homicide cases where the individual manifested traits of psychopathy, never committed a murder. Then there was a case of domestic violence inside the home. And for all of us in here, our options when you're involved, for example, in a domestic violent dispute, is to not murder your partner. But if your back is against the wall and you are an individual that is psychopathic, murder is part of your repertoire. For those of us that don't have those traits, we wouldn't even think about it. So most psychopaths are not violent until the circumstances present themselves, and they could be, which is why we can't administer the PCLR to incoming police officers or FBI agents, because we would be sued, because they would argue, why are you giving me that test when the majority of people who are psychopathic aren't violent? So you are violating my rights to privacy by giving me that test. I hope that makes sense.
There was, okay, so let's go to this side, because we haven't entertained this side, and
Keep Hi, Dr. coming. O'Toole, my name is Selena Muller. I'm actually here because my friend Bria invited me. She's an alumni here. But my question is, if you remember the first time you ever interviewed a murderer or someone dangerous and scary, and kind of how you felt coming to the field as a woman for your first time doing this, and then if you think back all these years later to the last interview you had and how kind of you changed and how you talked to these individuals.
So the question is, if I can think back to the first person that I interviewed that probably had psychopathic traits, and then over the years how I've changed when I look back?
Yeah.
Sure. So I started my law enforcement career in the San Francisco District Attorney's Office, and my first case involved individuals that I think, looking back, probably manifested traits of psychopathy. The first arrest that I made in the FBI, I thought I was arresting a mere bank robber, because I was assigned to the Bank Robbery and Violent Crime Squad. So my partners said, Mary Ellen, you put the handcuffs on him. Okay, good, I'll do it. Come to find out, he was a bank robber, but he was also a serial killer. So I knew he also manifested the traits of psychopathy. And to do that, you've got to go back and look at their criminal history. But as I really began to specialize and then got involved in the BAU, I realized a couple of things. In my background, I'm a mental health counselor. So I'm trained to be a good listener, and I'm trained to not act shocked when somebody tells me that they're a pedophile or something like that, because the first thing they're going to do is shut down on you. And so you really don't want that at all. So I learned that all I have to do is just listen and not be shocked, don't act offended, don't proffer an opinion about how sick and twisted that you must be. Just sit and listen and ask questions and give them the kind of the thinking that you've never seen anybody like this before. No one in all your experience has ever been like this before. And they will talk. But it took a little time to get there, but I had the background and training that made me realize they don't have to talk to me. They really don't. They can just sit there and shut down. So it's sort of a, it's a really good thing that you have that kind of rapport, that they will talk to you. I've never had somebody turn me down. The last serial killer that I talked to, I was in prison with him, and I wasn't in prison with him, but I was prison with him. And behind me were these six really physically fit correctional officers that were watching, because he's a serial killer. And he loved the limelight because he was being videotaped. And he said, you know, you're so stupid. I'm like, I don't care. I'll go home to my cat, Elvis, and I'll be just fine being stupid. So I don't care if he insults me. Why do I care? And then he said, you know, I could jump across this table and snap your neck before you even know what happened. And I'm looking around at these officers, and I'm thinking, well, what the hell do you think they're going to do while you're snapping my neck? And he proceeded to open up and talk about his crimes, what he did, how he did it. But I just didn't act ruffled at all. Now, sometimes, are my eyeballs spinning in my head? Yes, sometimes. But that's not my role at that point. My role is to let them talk and to not judge them.
Great. We have one question here, one question in the back, and then we have a few more. So we have some time.
My name is Brad Hunter. I've worked at Mason in positions ranging from part-time wage worker to non-tenure track assistant professor. And I've also worked as a geospatial analyst. My discipline is geography. I'm wondering, first of all, I don't know whether your program has a graduate part to it, graduate entity. I would guess the undergraduates, if there are any, are pretty much self-selected. From where do you draw your students? It would strike me that you would need very interesting backgrounds, hard science, social science, maybe even drifting into more, there is an anthropological element to this. Where do you find these people with a varied background that would feed into a program like this and succeed?
I would say, I'm looking over here at my faculty, I would say they come from many different kinds of backgrounds. As an undergraduate, I see more variety than maybe as a graduate student, but I'll use Professor Rancor, Emily Rancor here as an example. Emily got her degree in psychology and then went on to GW in DC and majored in forensic science, which is really a switch. Now you're going to all those physical sciences, which you don't typically get when you are studying psychology. So we certainly see that, and Chris Durack, who's sitting here, had a double major as an undergraduate from Mason in chemistry and forensic science. So he had all those challenging courses and then went on for his master's degree in forensic science. But you see a variety, and I think that's really good for the field because the field is so broad. You can work in a laboratory or you can work in the field as a CSI. And then we have Dr. Yim, who's our forensic anthropologist, who his background is started off with the interest in forensic anthropology. So again, it varies, but the field offers so many opportunities that you want students to come from a variety of different backgrounds so that they can almost pick and choose. I would rather be out at a crime scene, going through all the stuff that you see at a crime scene. In fact, Emily's first case is, some of you may recall, the Beltway Sniper. That was Professor Rancor's first case, and I asked her, what was your assignment as a CSI person on your first case on the Beltway Sniper? How many people remember crawling to their gas tanks,
yes,
right? Putting gas in her first assignment, you know what it was? They put her in the sewer so she could look for evidence. Am I right? They put Emily in the sewer to look for evidence. Did she balk at that? Not one iota. So variety is good. And from that, then you can start to choose what really fits well for you. You know what's been a blessing for our program? Our TV shows, like Law and Order, CSI, Bones for forensics. Our students grow up on those programs. I'll sit in my office sometimes, which is right next to the sitting area where the students are, and I hear them debating cases. Did you see Dateline? Did you see 2020? Did you see 48 Hours? So they grew up on that, and they love the challenge of a mystery from a scientific perspective. That has really helped us a lot. And again, they all come from different backgrounds.
That's wonderful.
Yeah,
I'm actually here. I drove out. I live right near the Fairfax campus. I drove out here this afternoon. Fortunately, I'm retired. But I had seen you on, 2020 or Dateline or some show of that ilk, and thought it might be interesting to hear you in person.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have a couple of questions in the back. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Chris Smith. I'm alumni from George Mason from many, many moons ago. Currently, I'm a mental health therapist here at Prince William County. I also work with the county police in regards to their hostage negotiation team. Thank you for your excellent work and your dedication to the service. One, I would say that my impression is in regards to the body farm is even though letting animals and grass grow up, it's trying to do as best as you can in regards to a controlled environment because that's what you're studying. Second, there's always the issue of science trying to catch up in regards to helping law enforcement, so I do appreciate all the efforts that you've been doing in that. Also well aware from psych perspective that, serial killers, serial rapists and things like that, they're not doing it all the time. There are periods of time in which they can go dormant. And a lot of that has to do not only with the characteristics that they're having, but it's something else has changed in their life in which has made it where they didn't feel the urge as strongly, or they had something else that was addressing that for them at those moments in time. And I think that's one of the other things that I think does sometimes make it difficult in regards to law enforcement and also in regards to the study of this is when they do go dormant, trying to figure out what changed for them. You gave a good example of the Golden State Killer who went dormant for a number of years because there was a significant change within his life. I guess my general question is, it's always going to be a case where science is trying to continue to catch up, and also in regards to the ethics of things. Could you just say a little bit about how one of the most important things I think that you're trying to make sure is always addressed is patience, that you have to let it take the length of time that it takes. And that's sometimes hard for especially young people to address. I mean, it's not, patience is something hard to teach. I know from a counseling perspective, growing up, it was always the idea of like, well, I should be asking more questions. And getting to a point of learning, no, I need to do more listening. I need to throw my question out there and just wait. And it's a hard thing sometimes to deal with science, silence and patience. So
you have hit the nail on the head. I was teaching interviewing at the FBI Academy for a number of years, and I would ask my classes, which would be police officers and FBI agents, how much out of 100% of the time when you're in an interview room, how much should you be talking and how much should the offender be talking? And the police and the agents would get it wrong all the time. How much do you think, if you had to guess, how much do you think the interviewer should be talking in an interview? It's about no more than 15%. And yet it's the hardest thing to do, especially if you're someone that's extroverted, that and you feel like taking control of the interview is really important. That's a fallacy to have that you have control of the interview. But you're right, having the patience to just sit there is so critical. How do you teach that? I'm not sure that I've ever mastered that because some people you can tell them, but they don't get it.
Yeah, maybe we can take one or two more. We're okay.
Hi, how are you? My name is Margaret. I'm an alumni from Mason. Many questions come to mind, but I'll ask two questions. The first is, and the concern is with society as it is, the young generation, the internet, and whatever else they have access to. Are there any studies where that you have seen where it says, where are we heading? Are we creating more psychopaths, serial killers? I mean, that's a big concern, you know. And the other is, I would like to know what were those points that you look for in a psychopath or a psycho killer. You know, the 10, was it 10 or 20 points?
That's right.
Greatly appreciated. Thank you.
Right.
So the question is, what are the, really you're asking, what are the trends going forward in violent crime? And we are seeing fewer serial killers, serial sexual killers. There are different types of serial killers, but we really pretty much focused on serial sexual killers, people that killed for sexual purposes. And we've seen a remarkable decrease in those kinds of offenders. They really kind of hit their stride in the 70s and 80s. We're still uncertain as to why. Some people said that was because there were more drugs used at that time, different kinds of drugs. Not sure I agree with that. There were also people that thought victims were more readily accessible because of hitchhiking. How many people in here ever hitchhiked?
Many years ago, but yes.
So, but we've seen the number of serial murder crimes go down, and I think part of that also is because of DNA, as we're able to, you know, find the offender sooner. So right about the time that serial murders went down, then we saw the mass shootings go up. And we still don't know what is contributing to mass shooters today is not what contributed to Columbine. And what contributed to the case down in Texas, Charles Whitman, in 1966, that was an outlier. We're still not sure. Well, they attributed to a brain tumor on the base of his neck. No, that predatory violence like that does not produce a mass shooter as we saw with Charles Whitman. So we're seeing a new trend that was not predicted. And here's, for me, what is so frightening. We do not know the full impact of the internet on people. We do know that sexual violence has increased. We do know that addiction to pornography has increased. In some of the cases, for example, that I worked prior to the internet really taking off, I had a number of cases involving sexually sadistic offenders, and these were the worst of the worst, and they were people that torture their victims before their victims are dead. Their violence is so extreme, at that time there was no way to get pictures so that would fuel their fantasies. So they would have to draw their pictures in order to fuel their fantasies. Now you can have a very aberrant sexual fantasy involving people or animals or something else, and all you have to do is go on the internet and you can find someone that shares the same fantasy, and they live halfway across the country. And now you've got a partner that helps you to normalize it. The full extent of the damage, and I love my Amazon, trust me, I do, but we do not know the full impact. And now the problem with the mass shooters is that it's become so metastasized in our society. We don't know how to pull it apart. We do not know how to pull it apart. And it's not all access to guns. It's been metastasized with influences we still haven't identified. So that's why we think we have got to get a handle on what's coming next. Violence is not going to go away. Violence now is younger. Violence now with younger people is far more violent. So there's probably more evidence of psychopathy in younger offenders, but we're seeing younger offenders all over the world now. You did not see that to the degree that we're seeing that today.
It's kind of scary. The concern is because if it's a part of it genetic, I mean, like how many of us have the gene for X disease, you know, or psychological, you know, be a psychopath. But not everybody's gonna be, something will trigger it, you know, and will, you know, the environment, I guess, some sort of factor there. Uh-huh.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Uh-huh. The majority of people that we could classify as having a psychopathic personality will never go on to be violent. You just don't want to work with them. You don't want to be in a relationship with them because they have the same traits as, say, a serial killer. We think about 95% of serial sexual killers have the traits of psychopathy. So you can run a company, you can run a country, you can be in certain careers and have psychopathic traits. It's not just limited to a serial sexual killer. So some of the traits of psychopathy are they're very charismatic. Very charismatic. I met Jim Jones. very charismatic Jim Jones. Remember the cult leader Jim Jones? Very charismatic. They have no empathy for their victims. They're cold and callous. They're extremely manipulative. Whenever you do go into a prison facility and you know you're going to talk to someone who probably manifests traits of psychopathy, they're going to ask you for something. They're going to ask you to bring them something or to do something for them. We know that they are huge risk takers. They infuse risk into their crime scenes. We know they're very unrealistic in their future plans. We also know that they have no guilt for what they do, and you can't impose the guilt in them. We also know that they do have juvenile records, but oftentimes a juvenile record may be so minimal that it's either not recorded or it's been screened. Psychopaths are not rule followers. So when they go on, when they're placed on probation, conditional release, something like that, we know that it will be a matter of time before they violate it because they don't follow society's rules. In fact, I actually had a case with the kidnapping and the murder of a little girl out of her home. And this was really before we had a lot of information on DNA. And I suggested we go back to, because being inside of somebody's home when you commit a violent crime, what that tells me experientially is that's not the first time you've been in a stranger's home. Does that make sense? I mean, how many of us could go in a stranger's home and commit a crime and feel comfortable? We couldn't do it. So when I looked at that crime, I suggested we get a hold of all of the parole officers in that area that had someone who was released 6 months prior to the home invasion and the child abduction case. It ultimately became a child murder case. And let's look for people who were paroled 6 months, because the research suggests that a psychopath, once they get out of prison, can last about 6 months before they reoffend. It was 6 months to the day.
Yeah, let's take one more question here, and then, I mean, we will have more time for questions with the team in the reception that we'll have afterwards, but go ahead.
Yeah, my name's Heidi Rabinowitz. I graduated quite a while ago at the program of mathematics. I also worked at the FBI Academy, was stationed down there for a while. I was also on jury duty where we had a catalog of body parts from somebody. So I've been on some very strange juries. We had a family friend where the girl was left for dead at Madeira School. They put the guy in the mental home. He walks away. Nobody held responsibility. He went back, and this time he got the girl and left her for dead. So where do you draw the line between putting the people in mental homes who have mental problems and protecting their rights versus society at large, and the people who let these people out on parole don't seem to have enough responsibility or held to account for letting the people come out at large to ruin society? So where do you draw those lines?
Well, it's a great question, and I don't... People that have far more expertise than I do in working in psychiatric facilities would be better equipped to answer that. But I will say this, when you work, and the gentleman behind you with the mental health background would be an excellent resource, but oftentimes when you do have, I mean, there are certain laws now within the United States that you can't hold people against their will. So you may be able to do what we did in California and done here. You might be able to size somebody up and say they pose a threat to self and others, and then they are committed to a psychiatric facility, and because of court orders, you may be able to get them to stay longer. But those people have rights no matter how you might feel about it, and they can be released. The only one that I'm aware of that stayed in a mental health facility for decades was Hinckley up in Queen Elizabeth's in Washington, D.C. But here's something that I learned as a mental health person, and I'd love to hear what your thoughts are on this. But oftentimes when you're doing those kinds of threat to self and other evaluations, you oftentimes are relying on self-reported information. Do you feel like you could, are you thinking about hurting yourself? No. Are you thinking about hurting somebody else? No. Have you thought about suicide? No. When's the last time you thought about suicide? Oh, maybe 2 weeks ago. Do you have access to weapons? Self-reported information, which is what our psychologists and psychiatrists have to rely on, is not reliable at all. So there are a lot of factors that come into play, and I have found that our mental health professionals, they don't want to be a part of allowing people to go out into the public that pose a danger, but there's a legal system and there are other issues that, that don't allow the, us to just stand there and say, this, you have to stay incarcerated. Okay. It's a great question.
So folks, the bad news is that we don't have any more time to continue this session, which has been fascinating. The good news, though, is that we have a reception over in the lobby where we'll have drinks and food, and you can continue interacting with Mary Ellen and the rest of our forensic science faculty. Additional good news, the next Mason Science series will be on April 24th on the Fairfax Country Club. We will have Professor Ramin Hakami discussing his work on catalyzing the body's immune system to fight infections such as COVID. I welcome everybody to join us on April 24th. I thank my dear colleague, Mary Ellen O'Toole, for this wonderful afternoon. Please give her a hand.
Thank you.